special session. If you say the word geography to anybody here on Broadway this afternoon, the odds are they're going to think of the National Geographic Society. The ubiquitous yellow rectangle is instantaneously recognized across the entire world, and the organization behind it has a proud and extensive history. For a very long time, National Geographic has been a strong advocate of the work of AGS, and we have been very grateful for their support, the support of our big sister, compared to AGS, our very big sister. During this 35th Annual Geography Awareness Week, National Geographic has selected our symposium to help lead the important discussions we are having. So this afternoon, we are proud to present the Chief Executive Officer of the National Geographic Society, Dr. Jill Tiefenthaler. As CEO, Jill oversees the Society's global nonprofit work and programmatic agenda across science, exploration, education, and storytelling to elevate the Society's mission of illuminating and protecting the wonder of our world. She also leads the Society's global community of National Geographic Explorers, of which two are joining us today, Dr. Maria Fadiman and Dr. Victoria Herrmann. And the three of them will do what Nat Geo does best, regale us with stories from the field. Jill?
Thank you, John, and good afternoon, everyone. It is wonderful to join you, and it's always fun to be with those who share our passion for geography as we celebrate Geography Awareness Week with you. As a small token of our excitement for being here, we brought little yellow pins for everybody, so I hope you'll grab one before you leave. I'm particularly thrilled to moderate today's panel because my background is at the intersection of food and the social sciences. I grew up on a farm in Iowa. My family still runs the family farm, and we grow popcorn there. I was hoping we get popcorn today, but I didn't get that organized. And I'm an economist by training, and I can't wait to dig into our conversation about the future of food, food security, and geography. As you can imagine, geography is very near and dear to us at the Society. After all, it's our middle name. So it's been a part of our legacy and identity since we were established 134 years ago, when our founders came together to, quote, increase and diffuse geographic knowledge. Today, using that geographic approach remains fundamental to our mission work, and it's particularly powerful when combined with storytelling. Take a look.
Storytelling is something that is so embedded in our daily life that we don't even recognize it. It's like the air we breathe.
Good stories can truly rally people to get behind certain things, certain causes.
The most impactful stories are not for the brain, they only serve as a heart.
I use storytelling to connect to people and places and ideas. Maps allow me to tell the stories within their geographic context.
Maps take you to another part of the world that you've never been to and may never get to, but you can dream about being there.
I wanted to make some maps that were profoundly important to this country. I had no idea that so much story was part of this map-making process. North does not have to be at the top. Scale is unnecessary. What's more important is this story is described in these vignettes.
The kind of stories I like to tell are stories of people, places, natural history.
Good stories elicit empathy, one of the most important rules of change.
We have mapped more of Mars and the Moon combined than we have for our ocean floor. This blows my mind. We're mapping something underwater that no one's seen before.
With our stories, we hope that people will fall in love with the ocean.
that we will inspire to protect them.
I use stories to help encourage conversation around topics that might be otherwise kind of difficult.
The screen book map that I'm developing really helps tell the story of not just the green book, but of our current situation with race and class in America today.
I think now more than ever, storytelling is a bridge of understanding to learn from each other and to inspire each other.
There is so much common ground between conservation, scientists, government agencies, and between people who are living with wildlife. People who've never met each other before tell a story and they have a little more understanding.
There is a depth and a wealth of stories underneath your feet and surrounding you at every given moment.
The map helps us to connect these dots and bring the whole story together.
Video really epitomizes our vision, and we use the power of science, exploration, education, and storytelling to illuminate and protect the wonder of our world. And much of that work is underpinned by geography. Geography provides us with a multidisciplinary, layered, holistic approach to understanding our world and people. It can be a powerful and inclusive approach for providing that common ground, as well as identifying the solutions we urgently need. For us, geography comes to life in many ways, through maps, of course, but also through educational materials. We have an incredible collection of geography-focused materials for young people around the world to use. Geography also shows up in our storytelling, as you just saw, through visuals and narratives that can help tell the story of our interconnected world. In fact, this morning I had the opportunity to visit National Geographic's newest exhibition, which is up here at the United Nations. Inside the Curve documents the work of more than 300 National Geographic grantees who tell the personal and profound stories of the pandemic in communities all over the world. In fact, more than 70 countries are represented. You can see it at the UN until December 2nd. In addition to storytellers, the Society supports a global community of scientists and educators, a total of more than 6,000 explorers around the globe. And they are helping to address many important challenges, including the future of food. So it gives me great pleasure to welcome two National Geographic explorers today. Maria Fadiman is an ethnobiologist, and Victoria Herrmann is a climate change researcher, and they both are very proud geographers. Victoria and Maria. Thank you. Welcome. I want to start with just having you tell us a little bit about your professional backgrounds, which are very distinct, and yet there are some similarities. How'd you get started, and what does the future of food look like from your vantage point in the work you do today? Maria?
So I came to geography fairly late. I did my bachelor's and my master's, and then for my PhD, I still had no interest in geography. So I do ethnobotany, the relationship between people and plants. And there was a very famous ethnobotanist at University of Texas at Austin. And I called and I said, hi, this is what I do. And, you know, like me, please, please, please. And she said, you sound pretty cultural. I said, okay. She said, why don't you contact the geography department? And I said, okay. And I hung up and I said, it's geography. So I called the geography department and I learned, and it's been an amazing fit, and I, looking at people and plants with geography, and we were just hearing, gives me a lens through which to look at what I do. And now I read between the lines. I come with a project, and then I see what is really happening and what people are saying that's not just about my project, and geography really opened me up to do that. And so now I work with people and plants in rural areas throughout the globe, and working specifically to keep that information alive, with working with young people, teaching them to interview their own elders, and creating trilingual, bilingual booklets to have a record. And for food, to me, I mean, working in a lot of these places, it's about the connection, the direct connection. Where does my food come from? What do I do with it? And for me to be learning that as well. So that's where I see a big moment in food for us.
Thank you, Victoria. So I went to college thinking that I would focus on human rights. I come from a family of Holocaust survivors, and I thought that if I had the privilege to go to college, I I should honor that legacy of my family. But when I got to college, I learned of something called climate change, and I realized that the climate crisis was the biggest human rights challenge of not just my generation, but every generation moving forward. So I shift gears to focus on the climate crisis, and that led me to geography. It led me to the Arctic, the front line of climate change, warming at almost 4 times the rate of the global average. And it has led me to my work today, which is committed to empowering and helping communities on the front lines of the climate crisis adapt to this existential threat. And the future of food, I think we've heard from lots of awe-inspiring speakers yesterday and today that it's both the greatest opportunity and the greatest challenge for the climate crisis. And hopefully we have some awe-inspiring problem solvers in the room that will move it from challenge to solution ever faster.
That's great. So Victoria, to follow up on that, when people think about the future of food, they often think about nutritional sustenance. But the issue, as we've learned, is much broader than that. What are some of the other issues that we need to address when thinking about the future of food?
Today, we focused a lot on food as security, food security, but also national security. I think of food as cultural security. We haven't quite hinted that next week is American Thanksgiving. So as we are talking about food a lot, I am thinking about the menu that my family will have next Thursday. And on our menu is matzo soup. So, you know, as a Jewish family, this is a dish that survived a genocide that was brought from my family who survived concentration camps from Europe from one generation to the next. I am eating my cultural heritage next week. And, you know, food is culture, but culture is also a tool for resilience. And that's really where my work focuses, because everyone has their own matzo ball soup, right? I'm sure each of you can think of what your food as culture is in your community, in your family. And in my first Nat Geo grant, America's Eroding Edges, I spent 2 years traveling across the U.S. and U.S. territories, and I interviewed just over 250 local leaders, from tribal elders in Alaska to the governor of American Samoa to mayors in Alabama, and asked what was climate change impacting in their community and what was needed at the national level to support them. And they talked about buildings and bridges, but they talked about losing the things that make them who they are. They talked about losing taro. They talked about losing fish. They talked about losing the food that connected them from past to present to future. So I think it is critical to think about food as security, food security, nutrition, national security, but not to lose the culture.
Thank you. Maria, a fellow explorer, Bob Ballard, has said that as an explorer, the expedition isn't over until you come back and share the story. So what are some of the stories in your work from the field highlighting the importance of this issue, and what maybe scares the heck out of you?
Well, there's one that comes to mind, and actually building on what Victoria just said, it was in Palau, so in the same region as American Samoa, and I was there to work with the plants and people. There was a firstborn ceremony, and I was there to look at the plants they use and the sustainability and the conservation, and while I was there, I also began to see the food plays a huge role in these ceremonies. And then I started to look at what the food was, and there's all kinds, but one of the things they get are these huge trays, and on it, and the amount of food is tremendous, and people get 5 trays, and they're taking them home, and you have the taro, and you have the fish, and then you have some pork, which is traditional-ish, and then there was rolled up, there's a little sushi roll. Japan had colonized Palau for a long time, so that has been incorporated now into their traditional ceremonies, the fluidity of culture. But next to the sushi roll, just glaring out at me, was a big Twinkie. And it wasn't just a regular Twinkie. It was the hot pink with the cream inside with flecks on it. And nothing to denigrate Twinkies. I grew up in California. It was super health foody.
parents, and I was never allowed Twinkies, and I used to fantasize about Twinkies. So I get Twinkies. But the problem here is that it's a huge problem. We've been hearing a lot about health, that NCDs, non-communicable diseases, mainly diabetes, is huge in this region. So when you're eating Twinkies, that is going to exacerbate that and create that issue in many ways. And when we look at how the Twinkie got there, you know, the Twinkie didn't swim across the Pacific and get there, the United States had a huge presence in Palau, and they were bringing non-perishable items. So Twinkies and Spam is huge there. You know, tinned meat, it makes sense. It's protein, and it doesn't rot. And it, you know, tastes really good in a certain way. And so now Spam has become huge there. When you go to the supermarket, and they've got the cereal aisle and the cracker aisle, they've got aisles that have Spam. And there's every kind of Spam. And then we went to Yap, a neighboring island, and they had Spam light. It's been healthier. But again, not to denigrate Spam, it's something that I was very excited, again, as a child. But this is all really influencing the health, and it's really taking over the traditional food ways of the taro and fishing of these people. And it's coming through again. You know, geography's helping me see colonization, globalization, the roles that all of these play in so many areas, and especially in food ways, in particular around the world.
Victoria, what about you, and what scares the heck out of you?
Well, as a climate researcher, everything scares the heck out of me. I get no sleep. For food, I think the thing that scares the heck out of me is the nexus of food and disasters. You know, we, as a world, are living in an era of extremes, and we've seen many charts throughout the day on how world hunger is not going in the right direction, and a big part of that is because of weather-related disasters. Our food systems are not prepared for the amount of disasters that we see year on year, the fires and floods and heat waves and hurricanes. And that is true on a global scale, but it's also true in the U.S. and U.S. territories. Last year, we experienced 22 $1 billion disasters. That was record-breaking. And each one of those disasters impacts our food systems, from crops to getting access to food in your urban community. It scares the heck out of me that those systems aren't resilient, and getting back to that, food as culture and culture as resilience. If you lose that tool of resilience, your community is less likely to bounce back after the next disaster. And those disasters don't hit communities equally. We know that communities of color, low-income communities, indigenous communities across the U.S. and U.S. territories are disproportionately impacted by disasters because of centuries of discriminatory policies and racism. So thinking about the increase of disasters, thinking about how equity is not where it needs to be in policy investment across this country, we have a whole lot of work to do to ensure that every community can not just withstand, but thrive living in an era of extremes.
So at National Geographic, we always want to be very straightforward and honest about the challenges we face, but we also like to think of ourselves as solution-focused and optimistic. Maria, hope.
Hope. So, in connecting with food as culture, I mean, it is just absolutely one of the same in so many ways. So I was just doing some research in Kosovo and Albania, and the traditional way that they thatch their roofs is with rye. And as time has gone on, they're now using more manufactured items like tiles and now from metal. But this rye, they also would grow it for their bread. And we heard Bob was talking about how important bread is. And so they would have this rye bread. As they're starting to move away from doing the roofing, they're also moving away from growing the rye. So one is, you know, to scare the heck, you know, we might lose this race of a grain. But then you think, well, this sounds totally not inspiring, but things change in really unexpected ways. So we're here and we're documenting this, and we're talking with a few older farmers who are still growing this rye, and they're talking about how they're the only ones left. And then we went into the urban areas. We're working in the villages, and we started to interview the bakers, and it's the Haas region, and they're famous for their baking. we're seeing this where it feels like it's going one way, and then something from another area is really bringing out this other element of it. So also with growing the rye, some people are talking about, well, that could affect the material culture for roofs that are sustainable and well aerated and all of that. So we see how culture and food and other aspects of manifestation, like roofing, come together, and that it's not just going one way.
Victoria, that's great. Some stories of resilience and hope from your work. Like some of maybe the most hopeful moments that I have had over the past few years have been in a follow-up project to America's Eroding Edges on bringing together communities being displaced by the climate crisis and communities that will receive climate-displaced residents in the U.S. and U.S. territories. By the end of this century, 13 million of us living along the coastlines will face displacement from sea level rise and more extreme storms. And in one of these workshops of bringing together receiving communities and displaced communities in Louisiana, we brought people together with food, faith, and music, the things that bind us to each other. And there is so much division and devastation and hatred that exists in this country. And to see communities come together, listen to one another about the real fears of receiving a new community, about the devastation that comes with leaving your home for many communities from time immemorial, and finding points of connection, friendships, and resilience that can be built together through food and through music and through faith, it was pretty hopeful. And I think, you know, we all work on different quasi-devastating topics of, you know, world hunger, climate, and hope can be really hard to come by. But hope is a really cool emotion because it is future-oriented, right? You can feel really hopeless today. You can read the latest climate report that is dire and tells us that we are acting too little too late, but you can be hopeful about the future because you know that everyone here, right, has a part to play in the solutions, and you know that the 100, 200 people I have met over the past 2 days that I didn't know previously are dedicating everything they have to creating those solutions, and you know that makes you hopeful about the future.
That's great. Just so to stay on this track, and Victoria to follow up, what are some of the things that you've seen or what you would recommend for in terms of policy and government action, business, etc.?
From a climate researcher perspective, we need all hands on deck for climate policy, which means we both need bottom-up and top-down action. I just had the privilege of spending the past year working as a White House fellow, so I had the chance to see up close what it means to make policy for hundreds of millions of people. And we absolutely need to be acting at a swifter pace for climate and food security in this country. And I think leaders at those top levels could do well to listen and learn through their partners around the world, partners like Finland, who have really perfected the circular economy and how to scale that, thinking about food as a circular economy, the biocircular economy, and being able to build those bridges between Finland and the U.S., but equally so with indigenous diplomacy, right? Australia and New Zealand are pioneering what it means to not only say, but invest and act on indigenous diplomacy, and building those points of connection for sharing indigenous knowledge and expertise on sustainable agriculture. And again, as the U.S., learning, listening, and then understanding how that applies to our domestic policies. But that doesn't mean that all of you are off the hook, even if you're not policymakers or presidents, because, like I said, we all have a part to play. If you are concerned about the climate crisis, if you are concerned about food in your community, show up in the places of power. Go to town hall. Does your city or town have a resilience plan? Does that include food?
So I spent much of my career before National Geographic in higher ed, and I always found being around students and young people so exciting and inspiring. And they're also really calling on us to task right now on addressing the issues we're talking about here. So you're both spending teaching. Talk a little bit about the conversations you're having with students now. Okay. So, I actually, so with my students, I actually now teach at the Environment and Culture Seminar. But this was the last seminar I developed, because in my other classes, I would bring up food here and there, and they just get fired up. And I think a lot of that is connected to social justice, to organic and all of that, but also you're saying food is culture. When you talk about Thanksgiving and you talk about it with your students, and you say, oh, well, you know, cornbread stuffing is right, I'm, aw, no, it's not. And people care. We're so connected to what we make. So with that, I was like, well, I'm going to do a whole class on this. So one of the things we do is I actually use food as a tool that at the break, everyone brings in food for everybody. And normally during the break in the class, we go, we check our cell phones. But in this, everyone sits around the table, and we talk, and we share food, and it creates a really different environment. And so then in the class itself, one is, people bring in a recipe that means something to them. So they bring in a recipe from their grandmother or something that they, when they were in Louisiana, they had this great experience. And then and it comes on paper, and I bring in little folders, and they leave with a recipe book by the end of the time from each of them. But then also, we read about so many of the issues that we've talked about today, but then also take them, we do field trips, and we go to people's personal gardens, and they see what they're doing. We go to community gardens, we go to urban gardens, and we go to restaurants where it's farm to table, and we go back into the kitchen, and looking at success stories of people looking at food in a different way and seeing there are ways to make this work. And then we go to a pizza restaurant, so it doesn't have to be all hoity-toity. We can do this where they're also doing that, so trying to give examples where they can see, yeah, this is happening, and to speak to also their interests. They're into it.
I teach an environmental communication course at Georgetown in D.C., and we talk a lot about the power of storytelling from the personal to the planetary, but we always get stuck on thinking about the balance between in climate change, climate mitigation, and climate adaptation. There is such an urgency to limit greenhouse gas emissions today and draw it down to zero well within our lifetimes. And it's challenging to tell complex stories where you need to simultaneously talk about climate solutions, climate tech that will get us to a net zero world, and the billions of dollars that we need for climate justice in adaptation and loss and damage. And so we have a lot of conversations on how do you tell a story that doesn't create an either-or between climate adaptation and mitigation, but a yes-and, that we can create this world where we do not have to choose between net zero and investing in communities to withstand a rapidly warming world. We haven't quite gotten to what that looks like. We keep getting better every semester, but I think it's a continuous conversation that doesn't stop in the classroom, but comes into at least my professional work and all the way up to the UN climate negotiations happening in Egypt right now.
Yes. So I was mentioning about our exhibit at the UN about the pandemic, and it makes me think about food and the pandemic and the impact on food. And you know, one of the photos at the exhibit was someone who had done their first garden during the pandemic, which I think happened. But in your work and your what impact did you see of the pandemic on food?
I saw food again as this point of resilience, right? Resilience doesn't stop at climate change. Resilience is the ability for your community, your household, to bounce back after a shock event. And the pandemic was arguably the biggest shock event that many of us experienced. climate change. That's why it's so important not to lose foodways and traditions and community food, because it is that point of connection in a disaster, in a natural disaster, where you can bring food to your neighbor. That is resilience, right? And you saw that shine in the pandemic, and it shows how important it is to value food as culture and as this tool of resilience.
Thank you. And it's interesting because in the rural areas where I work, they actually are very, in many ways, independent of this larger issue. So they are feeling more secure. And I was even with one group in Ecuador, and they said, well, in the cities, not even COVID, they said, well, you never kind of know where you get your food. And I think, well, yes, you do. You go to the supermarket. And they grow their food. And they said, we always know we can get food. And even during COVID, I was telling some friends, because now I'd gone to the supermarket and I'd seen what was happening. So these areas where they work, they don't have that. And they said, well, Maria, you could do something. And I was like, you know, what could I do? And then in the mail, they put the order on Amazon.com, came a jar and a little bag of sprout seeds. So I said, okay, maybe I do garden. So I made my little sprout jar. And again, it was this moment of feeling independent that I could take care of my own, some of my food needs myself. And that really came through kind of thinking about that, especially with the pandemic, where that became very real for all of us.
So one more question, then I'll open it up to the audience. Have you, when you, on your travels and your work and research, seen anything really inspiring or innovative in terms of where the future of where we're going with your work or food? For me, it is Finland and the circular economy, and not losing that connection to nature, and not just losing the connection, but breaking down the constructive division that we have created in Western society between nature and ourselves, and doing that intentionally through policy. I think that, from a policy perspective, is the future of food. For my work in the Arctic, the future of food is in question right now. We saw the map of how warm and how different the U.S., including Alaska, looks now, and how different it will look in 50 years. And that means that there is opportunity to grow where we have not previously grown. So the future of food doesn't just look like technology or new types of meats that aren't meats. It also looks like a different map of where we grow things and who has the power to grow things. I think, you know, your point, food is power, that is something that is awe-inspiring, right? That is a direct, power to community opportunity as those maps expand of where you can farm and who owns those farms as we move further north. I think the future of food can look more just as those maps change.
And I love this because I often think, well, in a way, looking at what are people doing again at the ground level, and there are good things. So in Latin America, I work in a lot of the rainforest areas, and one of the things that many of these groups do is that it's a kind of agriculture with this tres Marias, the three Marias, and my first name is Maria, so probably that's the whole reason I like it. But it is, we talked, people were speaking about mimicking the actual ecosystem. So in the rainforest, I mean, a lot of people know you've got all this fabulous growth and it's just bursting everywhere. And so the assumption is the soil is also fantastic. And all of that fabulousness is what you're seeing. The soil is only good for about a foot, so this is not good soil for farming unless you do it right. So they have this way where they do this, and again, it is to scale. It has to be in smaller areas, but where they will grow the corn, which would be the trees, and then you grow the beans, which would climb up the trees. These would be the vines. And as we talked about, other people have spoken about how legumes can get the nitrogen from the air. They can break those bonds, and they can capture nitrogen that the other plants can't. So the beans get it, but they spill it out into the soil, so the corn is happy. And so you've got this great soil, and then they plant squash, and that covers the soil and protects this really rich soil. And then through this, also with nutrition, you have beans and corn, which are creating a complete protein, and squash,
question. Please.
Fadiman Johnson, he, him, racial equity and social justice leader, Esri, nonprofit founder, organizing a global community of black geographers, always talking about equity. I'll answer one of your questions first. Sweet potato pie, candy games. And then I'll ask a question. So we know that equity and social justice challenges us. Well, first of all, they recognize that different systems of oppression target people to provide benefits and burdens based on their social identities. So it challenges us to understand how our stories, our experiences, our resources differ by our social identities, our race, our gender, all these intersections. So I'm curious if you know of any great resources that disaggregate this data, this content, this context by race, and does it in an unapologetic way. And if you don't know of any, why do you think there might be?
So I do not know of any. Most of the data that I work with is in the Arctic, and in those sets, it actually is a minority of the population across the 8 countries that are currently in the Arctic are indigenous, but most of the data sets that are from universities in Alaska, in Canada, and then in the Nordics, not so much Russia anymore, do break down between not just indigenous white folks that have colonized the Arctic, but within indigenous, break it down by Yupik, Inuit. And so I don't know of any on a global scale or in U.S. territories. And why is that? I think that the U.S. is wildly late to a racial reckoning in data. We are still not there, and it is not well-funded. I think if you look to big funders of data, there is an earnest desire to fund that research, but we have not yet seen the results of equity being a focus in places like the National Science Foundation. I think it is getting there. I think we will have those data sets, but I think we are so wildly late to that reckoning that data is just reflecting our history of discrimination at this point.
Please. Yep. Thank you.
Hello. Cole. Pharmaceutical student. I also am a practicing conceptual performance artist, and I wanted to ask y'all, well, first I should tell you, I don't know if you know of Mel Chin, an amazing community artist based in concept whose art has literally revitalized and rebuilt and economically brought life to communities, especially in Detroit. And I'm wondering if for the future of food, if you see art not only as a concept, but also as a necessary community-based praxis that contributes to the future of food, and how might you see that being played out?
Interesting question. Absolutely. And I love it that you're going that way. So I was part of a project, and we were trying to raise, it was not about food, it was about awareness in the Amazon and oil exploration. But they brought me along, I think, to have an academic as part of the crowd, but the rest of them were artists. And so they were working with photography, and they were working with film. And one, you would probably know the words better, he does structures, and he just creates art where he saw it. And so at one point, we were out with this indigenous community, and he was using a plant to draw on some pieces of paper. And then the children, he asked the children, could you get some stones to put on this so they don't blow away? And then the students, the village kids ended up finding some pieces of pottery of their own. And they were using that, and so he incorporated that into this
potential to show what is possible. It is really hard to imagine a future that is radically different than what we see around us, and art is this inspiring tool through which you can open people's eyes and show them what is possible, and you can also open people's eyes and show them what is the ugly that is right in front of them. So I think that art is essential. It is not this ancillary component of any solution. It is essential. And a new project that I will be starting soon, but can't talk about right now, that is at the nexus of the climate crisis and cultural heritage, funds for artists in residence for this reason, because art is necessary.
I'm a grad student at the George Washington University, and this was an amazing talk. I love how you guys communicated with each other about the greater importance of communication through storytelling. So I was just wondering, either with your work as an individual or as an explorer, how you're using the storytelling and your research experience to conduct change, whether this is with policymakers or NGOs. I know you said you were a White House fellow, so I would be a little bit more interested in learning what that entails.
So for all students and early mid-career folk in the audience, you should all Google White House Fellows, because it is an awesome opportunity for people across the U.S. and U.S. territories to spend 1 year shadowing a cabinet secretary or a military service chief to learn how our government works at the highest levels. And it was an amazing experience for me and a growing experience. So. Please, everyone, Google that and apply and come talk to me if you want to apply so I can help you. I think storytelling is somewhat absent in our federal government. I think everyone should have a chief storyteller in their government so you can tell stories that connect your nation and tell the hard stories that also bring people together. So I think storytelling in my last year was a little lacking, but as Nat Geo explorers, we tell stories all the time, right? We tell stories on stage, we tell stories to the people next to us on the train, because that's how you affect change. You affect change by creating conversation, by sharing your lived experience and being open to hearing others. And I tell people, not in food, but in climate work, that the biggest thing that you can do after leaving an event is talk to 5 people about what you learned at the event, right? The person that you were sitting next to at the bus stop, your mom that you call on your walk home. Tell them about what you learned and ask them to share it with someone else, because that's how we affect change, by building the shared knowledge.
And just with the stories and that, so when I was for my PhD program, when I was interviewing for it, and they said, "Oh, do you want to be a professor?" I said, "No." I said, "I want to, and I'm going to work for some big organization, and I'm going to save the world directly, and it's going to be a conservation organization." He said, "Okay." So, why don't you say you want to be a professor? All right. So, and I would like to save the world or be a professor. And then I found out being a professor really was a fit for me in terms of storytelling, and how I still feel like I'm trying to make a difference, is I feel like when I bring stories back and I connect my students, not just with the concept, but the person who is living that concept, the child that is picking the cacao plant, crashing against a tree and giving me a taste, and then we look at agricultural practices throughout the world to make it personal, kind of with the art where you bring people in and then they see these other elements. And with that, I'm clearly, as every professor and all of the teachers who are here, we're trying to inspire in our students for them to make the difference that works for them, for their strength.
Scientifically, we know that it is really, really hard to limit warming to 1.5 degrees at this point. It is unlikely that we will see monumental commitments come out tomorrow that will get us closer to 1.5 degrees. One thing that is, for me, the most hopeful news that has come out of Egypt is the EU's decision to fund loss and damage. Loss and damage is this thing in climate change that exists beyond adaptation, right? It is the things that we lose, the culture. It is the damage that is inflicted on those with little responsibility in communities around the world that did not pollute but are receiving the biggest impacts. Loss and damage has been a real sticking point in negotiations for the past 20 years, and we might finally see real movement come out of Egypt tomorrow on loss and damage. So I would say that is the biggest news that I hope to read tomorrow night, but I am not optimistic about the mitigation commitments that will reach further to get us closer to 1.5 degrees. Sorry to end on that note, but thank you.